Good morning and welcome to Church of the Resurrection here on Capitol Hill in DC. My name is Sulmane Megadi. I'm one of the pastors here, and we are glad that you can join us today on the sixth Sunday after Easter. I'll invite you to stand as we begin the service together. Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Together, let's pray the collect of purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's sing together. What our Lord Jesus Christ says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God, first in silence, kneeling or standing as you are able. Most merciful God, We confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Please rise and let's sing the praises of the Lord. Together, let's pray the collect for the children. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, you have blessed our congregation with the joy and care of children. Give us courage, patience, and wisdom as we bring them up in the faith, that they might never know a day apart from you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Alleluia! The Lord is risen. Easter is a time of great celebration. God has raised Jesus from the dead, and through Jesus, God is making all things new. So we don't celebrate Easter for just one Sunday. We celebrate Easter for 7 whole Sundays, all the way until Pentecost. So it's still Easter. Happy Easter! Easter is 50 whole days of feasting and celebrating and looking at the world around us and seeing all the ways that God is bringing new life to our world. And during Easter time, we've been talking about the stories in the Bible where Jesus appears to his disciples in his new resurrected body. Today's story comes from the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew is one of the first 4 books in the New Testament. And these Gospels tell us the good news of Jesus' birth and about his life and about his death and about his resurrection. I wonder, can any of you remember what happens in the first part of Matthew? That's right, at the very beginning of Matthew, we learn about the birth of Jesus, the Christmas story. And in the Christmas story, the Magi, or the wise men, the 3 kings, came from foreign lands to worship Jesus, who was a baby and a king. He was God with us, Emmanuel. And through that story, we learn that the good news of Jesus is not just for God's people, the Israelites, but for the whole world. And today, in our story, the disciples, just like the 3 kings, will worship Jesus. Because Jesus is preparing to go back to his Father, and he is going to give these disciples a special mission to tell the whole world about him. But Jesus will also give them a promise, an Emmanuel promise to be with them. Let's make our hearts quiet and get ready to hear from God's good words to us today. This is Galilee. This is the Sea of Galilee. After God raised Jesus from the dead, the disciples returned to the mountain in Galilee, just as Jesus had told them to do. And when they saw Jesus there, they worshiped him. But some of them doubted. And Jesus said to them, "I am sending you to the whole world to do what I have done and to show everyone the way of the kingdom of God. I am commissioning you to do this." And Jesus said some special words to them. He said, "I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Go to the people in all the nations and make them my disciples. Baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And teach them to do everything I have told you. I will be with you until the end of the world." Now, this might seem like the end of the story. And sometimes when a story ends, it's sad. We don't want to say goodbye to the characters. We don't want to say goodbye to Jesus as he gets ready to go back to his Father. That's how the disciples felt. Let's listen and see what happens next. When the disciples received the power of the Holy Spirit, they were filled with the Holy Spirit and so much love that they were able to do just what Jesus had asked them to do. They were able to go and to cast out unclean spirits. They were able to go and heal the sick, just like Jesus had healed the sick. they were able to go and care for the poor and the needy. And they all shared the good news of Jesus. They shared about his life and his death on the cross and his rising to new life with everyone who would listen. They did this first in Jerusalem, and then in Judea and in Samaria, and in all the nations, showing the way of the kingdom of God and baptizing everyone who wanted to follow Jesus. But even this is not the end of the story. This ending is actually the beginning. Like Jesus' disciples, you and I are invited into this story to join in sharing the good news of Jesus, of his death and his resurrection with the whole world, and to follow wherever he leads. You see, the words of the Great Commission are not just for Jesus' disciples back in the Bible, but they're for us too. Let's read them again together. It says, the Great Commission, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." Let's wonder together about God's good words to us. I wonder, how do you think the disciples felt being close to Jesus and being able to worship him? I wonder how the disciples felt when Jesus gave them this special mission and sent them out into the world to show the way of the kingdom of God. I wonder, what do you think they'll tell people about Jesus? I wonder how the disciples feel to have Jesus with them, even when they can't see him. How do you think they know that Jesus is with them? Do you think they'll always follow Jesus, even when they can't see him? I wonder, how do you feel knowing that Jesus gave you this same special mission? Do you ever feel scared or nervous to tell other people about Jesus? Do you ever feel like you might not have the right words? Let's take a few moments to talk to God about what it looks like to follow him and be a part of his great commission and to be a part of his story. Let's pray together. Jesus, you gave your disciples the Holy Spirit so that they could fulfill your great mission. Give us your Holy Spirit today and show us how to follow you so that we can spread the good news of your kingdom. Thank you for giving us your promise to be with us always. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
And together let us pray the collect of the day. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. O God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as surpass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love towards you that we, loving you in all things and above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please give your attention to the reading of the lessons.
Our first lesson this morning is from Genesis chapter 15, beginning at verse 1. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. "Fear not, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great." But Abram said, "O Lord God, what will you give me, for I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus." And Abram said, Behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. This man shall not be your heir. Your very own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and number the stars if you are able to number them. Then he said to him, So shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today is Psalm 66, verses 1 to 9, and we'll read this responsively by whole verse. Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that your enemies come cringing to you. All the earth worships you and sings praises to you. They sing praises to your name. Come and see what God has done. He is awesome in his deeds toward the children of man. He turned the sea into dry land. They passed through the river on foot. There did we rejoice in him, who rules by his might forever, whose eyes keep watch on the nations. Let not the rebellious exalt themselves. Bless our God, O peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard, who has kept our soul among the living and has not let our feet slip. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Our New Testament lesson this morning is from Galatians chapter 3, beginning at verse 1. O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified. Let me ask you only this. Did you receive the Spirit by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Are you so foolish? Having begun by the Spirit, are you now being perfected by the flesh? Did you suffer so many things in vain, if indeed it was in vain? Does he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you do so by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Just as Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. Know then that it is those of faith who are the sons of Abraham. And the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, In you shall all the nations be blessed. So then, those who are of faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hi, I'm Dan Clare. I'm one of the pastors here at the Church of the Resurrection. It's so good to be with you again today. Today, we're going to be looking at Galatians chapter 3. And we continue our study of Paul's epistle to the Galatians. And I want to talk with you today about the big picture. What is this all about? Not only Paul's letter to the Galatians, but even a bigger picture, which is what are we about here? What are we doing? And what is Christianity for? What's the big, hairy, audacious goal of Christianity? That's where we're headed as we look at Galatians chapter 3. Before we begin, let's pray together. We thank you, Almighty God, for your love and your faithfulness, your mercy shown to us in so many ways, but especially today, we thank you for the good news of Jesus Christ and for how it's revealed to us in the Scriptures. And we pray that you will open the Scriptures for us now. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and fill us so that we might be able to hear from you and learn from you, and then be guided by you as we go out together from here. And this we pray in Jesus' name, amen. As we explore Galatians 3, 1 through 9 together today, I want to show you three things from this passage. First of all, I want to show you the gospel promise that's in this passage. And then I want to talk about the gospel patriarch. And finally, let's talk about gospel practice. So first of all, the gospel promise. And let's look at Galatians chapter 3, verse 8, towards the end of today's reading, where Paul writes, "And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, 'In you shall all the nations be blessed.'" In today's lesson, Paul reminds the Galatians and us, of course, of the big picture by going back to the beginning, back to the book of Genesis, and quoting God's promise to Abraham, "In you all nations shall be blessed." God's promise to Abraham wasn't just for Abraham, was it? Nor was it just for Abraham's biological descendants, the Jews. It was for everyone, for Jews and Gentiles, for all nations, is what it says. Everyone someday under the blessing of God. That's a good way to summarize the big picture of what Paul is writing about to the Galatians and the big picture of the Bible. It's also the big picture of what we're about here today. It's always easy to lose sight of the big picture, to miss the forest for the trees. It's happened quite frequently to me over the past 3 months since we became owners of this building, this 140-year-old building, and trust me, it shows. We're still in the discovery and the triage phase of what to do, what to fix, and in what order. And I've had the privilege of hearing from a number of different experts here at Res, as they have looked into things that need to be repaired and quickly. For example, Hannah Powell and Matt Lukey and Wimberly Hogendorn have climbed all over this building examining what we need for heating and cooling. And as I've listened to them talk about what we need, I've been very intrigued by the solutions that they've come up with. And I've done a lot of thinking about mini splits and space packs and other innovative solutions. And then Paul Borchers gave us this really interesting report about the lighting solutions that we need. And I had no idea of all of the things that were involved. And I spent several hours on the internet following rabbit trails and searching all kinds of things about lighting. And then just this past Sunday, we heard an amazing report from Nick Robison, who talked to us about our most urgent audio-visual needs for the building. It was an astounding presentation, and my heart was strangely warmed by a spreadsheet, believe it or not. But Nick just has that ability. And I could go on to tell you about all kinds of other things we plan for the building, the windows and the roof and the wiring and the plumbing and everything else. So many details, so many high priorities, but what's it all for? Where are we headed with this? The big picture, of course, is the total renovation of this old place, to restore it to its former glory and to move it forward, to update it for comfort and safety and for durability, of course. But even beyond that, what are we doing here? That's not the only thing we're after, because actually what we're hoping to do is to see this building become useful to the Lord as an embassy for Jesus Christ, night and day, every week, 365 days a year, an embassy of Jesus Christ here on Capitol Hill. That's why we're doing all of these little renovations, and every wall that gets painted, every switch that gets fixed, every window pane that gets replaced is one step closer towards the dream of making use of this place and loving God and loving our neighbors. There's a wonderful side benefit that we are realizing as we get involved in the renovation of this building, and that's the enduring illustration of the gospel promise that we see as we're involved in this renovation project. Because we're all very much like this old building, aren't we? We're built for glory, but of course, at present, we're burdened by sin. We're all in a state of disrepair due to the corrosive power of sin. Our sin, as well as the sin of others against us, as well as all of the consequences of sin from those in the generations before us, all that has been piling up century after century and has left us and our whole world needing comprehensive renovations. And just like with this old building, it's easy to miss the forest for the trees because the consequences of sin are everywhere, and there's so much renovation to be done. Just think about all of the nonprofits here in the city of Washington with their big mission statements that are focused on one small slice of the sin problem in our world, from criminal justice reform to affordable health care to environmental conservation to human trafficking. Thousands more different organizations all offering solutions to different parts of the problem of sin socially in our nation and our world. All of them exist to address these different problems. And yet, even if all of these .orgs were to succeed in their mission, we know that there would still be so much more work to be done because of the sin that remains personally, privately, within each of us. We're all intimately familiar with this aspect of the renovation work that has to be done. Areas of sin in us, things that we have done or left undone, things that have been done to us. We all need forgiveness for our sins. We all need counseling for our broken hearts. We need re-education for the renewing of our minds and healing for our broken bodies. And again, it's so easy to get caught up with any one of these areas and to miss the forest for the trees and lose sight of the gospel promise, what all these renovations are for. The gospel promise is bigger than simply getting our hearts squeaky clean. It's even bigger than solving all of the social problems of our city, our nation, and our world. For the gospel promise is what Jesus described for his disciples as the renewal of all things. Through his triumph over sin and death, Jesus made a way for everything that is broken in our world to be restored. And so we are promised in Revelation chapter 21 that he will wipe away every tear, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things will have all passed away. And Jesus says, "Behold, I am making all things new." That's what this is all about. It's because of the gospel promise that we're doing what we can to preserve and amplify the use of this place as an embassy for Jesus Christ on Capitol Hill. He's the one who is making all things new here. And it's because of the same gospel promise that the Apostle Paul long ago wrote this passionate letter to the Galatians, challenging them not to take their eyes off of Jesus, through whom they had all been born again. And it's because of the same gospel promise that some 2,000 years before Paul wrote to the Galatians, God spoke to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, saying, "In you shall all the nations of the earth be blessed." Abraham is the gospel patriarch, and that's the second thing I want to talk with you about from today's passage. So, number two, the gospel patriarch. The problem with the Galatian churches, as we've been learning, was that false teachers had slipped in among them and had distracted them from the gospel promise. Look at chapter 3, verse 1. Paul writes, "O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified." When Paul visited the Galatians and began to share with them the good news of the gospel, it was as if his message was so vivid that they were transported back to Good Friday in Jerusalem, and they saw Jesus up on the cross. They saw him dying for the renovation of the world. But then the false teachers came after Paul had gone back home. And they talked about how Jesus was Jewish and how Jesus came not to abolish the Old Testament, but to fulfill it. And so, if they wanted to follow Jesus, they had to become Jewish too. They had to be circumcised. They had to engage in the kosher food practices. They had to go on separating themselves from Gentiles and so on. And so the Galatian Christians lost the forest for the trees. Their vision shifted from Jesus up on the cross down to their very non-Jewish genitals. Their eyes came off of Jesus and onto themselves, And as Paul says, when they took their eyes off of Jesus, they were bewitched, they were mesmerized, they were preoccupied then with their own works of the law in verse 2. Now, Paul is going to break this spell with a theological tour de force that's going to take up the next two chapters. And we're only going to scratch the surface on it today, and we'll be talking about it for several weeks to come. What I want to highlight for you today is Paul's starting point. He's modeling something very important for us here, and we can find it in verse 6. Paul writes, "Just as Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness." You may recognize that line from today's Old Testament lesson from Genesis chapter 15, verse 6. What Paul is modeling for us here is how we should respond whenever some new teaching comes along. Our first response must always be to go back to the scriptures, back to God's word, back to the story, and see if there's alignment. It's a brilliant strategy that Paul uses here, by the way. The false teachers were saying that the Galatians had to become real Jews. Paul says, okay, let's talk about that. What do the scriptures have to say about that? And he takes us way back to almost the beginning of the story, to Father Abraham, the gospel patriarch, through whom God promised that all nations of the earth shall be blessed. Now, if you're not familiar with the story, God called Abraham at one of the darkest moments in all of human history. In the beginning, God created the world, and he brought light and life and order out of the primeval chaos. But then humanity fell into sin, and the chaos came rushing back, decreating the good world that God had made. And with every generation, the weight of sin grew heavier and heavier until, in Genesis chapter 11, humanity banded together against God and took a stand against him. And God intervened to scatter them. And it might have been the end of the story right then, but then in Genesis chapter 12, something wonderful happened. God called Abraham. He called him right out of the place where all of that unity against God had happened. God called Abraham out of Mesopotamia to begin his great renovation project. One family, Abraham and his wife Sarah, to follow him, just as we read in verse 8. And through them, God promised to bless all nations. Abraham and Sarah took this enormous leap of faith to leave behind their family and culture in order to follow the Lord. And as the story unfolds in the book of Genesis, we discover that they were actually childless and aging when they started out. And after making the long journey from Mesopotamia to Canaan, they continued to be childless and they were older. And after they settled down eventually there, they were yet still older and still childless. And with each passing year, the chances of Sarah ever getting pregnant became slimmer and slimmer. So eventually, as we read in today's Old Testament lesson, Abraham cried out in anguish to the Lord, saying, "Behold, you've given me no children." And as we heard, God didn't strike him down or scold him in any way. Rather, God opened Abraham's eyes to the big picture, to the gospel promise, giving him a glimpse of it. God said to Abraham, "Look up in the sky, count the stars if you're even able to count them." And then he said, "So shall your offspring be." And that big picture was just what Abraham and Sarah needed. After all of those years, having traveled so many miles and still no baby, it's easy to see how they had lost sight of the big picture and how their eyes, their gaze had fallen down upon themselves, and particularly on their apparently malfunctioning genitals. Month after month, year after year, they became distracted with their own brokenness, wondering, "What's wrong with us?" But when God lifted their eyes back up to him, they lost their egocentrism, and they gained the necessary theocentrism. And as Paul says in verse 6, Abraham believed God. He trusted God. And God regarded him as righteous, which is to say that Abraham was included among the people of God. He was welcomed in. Now, here's why this episode is so important to Paul's letter to the Galatians. That magical moment under the stars when Abraham's eyes were lifted back up to the Lord, Abraham's conversion experience, if you will, happened long before the introduction of circumcision into Abraham's story as a sign of the covenant. I even wonder if part of the reason that circumcision came into play later on was to keep Abraham looking up rather than down, to keep him looking up to the stars and looking to the Lord who could bring life even out of his old body. If the renovation of the cosmos was somehow going to come through him, God would have to intervene somehow. And so it was that Abraham, the gospel patriarch, the first of many who by faith experienced a kind of resurrection from the dead, happened to put his faith in Jesus. And Isaac, the child of the promise, was born to Abraham in his old age when he was as good as dead. And then some years later, at the very last moment, Isaac's life was rescued from death on Mount Moriah, the place of the skull. Right there, centuries later, another miraculously conceived son of Abraham would someday be crucified for the sins of the world. Abraham, the gospel patriarch, trusted God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Like him, we too are welcomed into God's family, not because of circumcision or any other works of the law, but because we also, like Abraham, are as good as dead. Rather, it's by faith in Jesus, whose death and resurrection guarantees our own complete renovation and the renovation of the world. So, in today's New Testament lesson, Paul took the Galatians back to the scriptures, and he showed them how the teaching that they had received about the necessity of circumcision actually didn't square with the original story. If circumcision was irrelevant to the inclusion of Father Abraham, the gospel patriarch, then why should it matter for any of them? Instead, they ought to return to the gospel practice of faith in the Lord. And that's the third thing that I want to talk with you about today. So thirdly, gospel practice. And here's where it gets really practical. Look at Galatians chapter 3, verse 2. Paul says, "Let me ask you this. Did you receive the Spirit by works of the law or by hearing with faith?" In other words, what's behind this renovation project, guys? Is it you or is it God? Have you considered the massive scope of the work that has to be done, both inside every one of us and also socially, nationally, globally? This is just so much bigger than any one of us. And do you really think that it's going to be your muscles that are going to get the job done? Look at verse 5. Paul comes back with the same question or something very similar. He says, "Does he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you do so by works of the law or by hearing with faith?" In other words, look around at all of the progress that has happened in your churches, all the renovations that have already occurred. Do you really think that you can claim responsibility for these things, for the transformed lives, for the healings, the reconciled relationships, the provision of resources, all the wonderful things that God has been doing in your midst? Have these miracles been because of you? No, they're the work of the Holy Spirit among you. Sure, leathery old Abraham was intimate with that wrinkled bride of his, but do you really think that they made a baby on their own? Of course not. It was miraculous. It was God. It was God who intervened to bring life out of death, just as he did again when you trusted in him. You Galatians, you Washingtonians, everyone who's watching today, if you've trusted in him, it's the miraculous, life-giving work of God. And because you've trusted in him, it's counted to you too as righteousness. Just think about it. Who is responsible for the renewal of all things? It's Jesus, right? All our problems we send to the cross of Christ, right? Or is it just some of our problems? Are there some that we send to Jesus and some that we keep for ourselves? All our problems, except, of course, relationships or job or money or sexuality or addiction or whatever it is we're holding back, we send all of them, except for those things, to the cross of Christ. Except for those things that are painful, the things that hurt us so much, we'll keep those here. I'm going to keep those with me in my worn-out body. I still want to work on some of these things, God. I'm not ready to hand these things over to you yet. I need to work on them a little longer. Maybe I can fix them myself. See, this is oftentimes the way it goes. How's that working for us? Have you noticed how much time and energy and attention these things we hold back from God constantly require of us? How they keep us from looking up to Him and continually gazing at ourselves. Our eyes have wandered away from the Lord and onto ourselves. It's time once again for the gospel practice of faith. Really believing in God for the renewal of all things, including those things that hurt us the most. Time to turn our eyes back on Jesus, to really trust Him for resurrection life, not only in the future, but in the present, in all of the areas of deadness in our own lives. And not only do we need this individually inside, but we also need it as a congregation, because like the Galatian churches, contemporary congregations can become bewitched. It happens every 4 years in our country as we take our eyes off of the Lord and we put them on presidential candidates. Suddenly, all our problems we send to this candidate or that candidate rather than to the cross of Christ. And if the right candidate wins, well, you would think that salvation has come. If the wrong candidate wins, well, it's like the end of the world. And of course, the same thing is happening all the time whenever a congregation becomes hyper-focused on some distinctive practice or belief rather than on the Lord. Just as the Galatians were Christians in name, but actually circumcisionists in practice. In the same way, contemporary churches can become practically bewitched. It's easy to spot this in other traditions where, say, they're all about the gift of prophecy, or everybody in the church is a vegetarian. It's always harder to see this, though, in ourselves, in our own church. But perhaps it's helpful for me to say that res is not exclusively for people who work for the federal government. Res is not a church only for people with college degrees, and it's not a church for people who only drink coffee in the morning and whiskey at night. Yet sometimes it can feel as if there is something other than Jesus that unites us as a congregation. And whenever that happens, it's time for us to remember and repent and turn our eyes back to Jesus. Whatever else we may have in common, it's only faith in Him, that gospel practice that matters. That's the only thing that should unite us. And it's for this reason that over the last several years, we've given so much time and attention to how we engage matters of ethnicity and culture, including the upcoming #LeaveLoud discussions. As a majority white congregation, we want to understand what it's like for people of color to be a part of our community. And ultimately, we want to do everything that we can to make sure that everyone feels welcome, regardless of ethnicity or nationality or age or gender or class or education or anything else that might divide us. Because again, it's faith in Jesus that is what we have in common at Church of the Resurrection. And this is why even in our foundations class, in our membership covenant, whenever we talk about our church, we want to say, yes, we're an Anglican congregation, but we're little a Anglican, big C Christian, because it's Jesus, not Anglicanism, that it's at the center of what we do and who we are. Anglicanism is a way to follow Jesus, but it's not the only way. And what's most important is that we're all following Jesus by faith, that gospel practice that unites us. Listen, if you haven't put your faith in him, how about today? Isn't it time to do so? Do you have the muscle? Do you have really what it takes on your own to accomplish even your own renovations, much less the renovations of the entire world? Jesus is the only one who has conquered sin and death. And by putting your faith in him, you will have access to his renovations from now and for the rest of time. He will do this work in you. I would love to pray with you if that's something that you would like to do. If you would like to become a Christian, let me know. And for everyone else who may be distracted, if your eyes have somehow drifted away from the cross of Christ, let me encourage you to get really honest about your situation, to become really honest with the Lord. Who's behind this renovation project? Is it you? Or is it God? Every day, every morning, we have to go back to the starting point, to where it all began, back to faith. Faith in the only one who's conquered sin and death. All of our problems, all of them, we send to the cross of Christ. And all of our hopes for the renovation of ourselves and the renovation of the entire world, we set on the risen Christ. Let's pray together. We thank you, Lord, for this glorious vision and the promise of the gospel, a promise that began with Abraham and continues all the way to the present. And we trust you for this renovation work to continue in this old building, in our old bodies, in our relationships, and in everything that is broken in our world. We long for your renovation work to shine in us and all around us. And so we put our faith in you once again, praising you for your grace and mercy in our lives. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please kneel or be seated as you are able. Let us pray for the church and the world, saying, Lord, hear our prayer. For the peace of the world and for the well-being and unity of the people of God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For Foley Beach, our Archbishop, and Steve Breedlove, our Bishop, for all the clergy and people of our diocese and congregation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all those who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach and disciple others, we remember today Anna Rickrode, serving with InterVarsity at Bucknell and Susquehanna Universities. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our brothers and sisters in Christ who are persecuted for their faith and for those who persecute them, we remember especially today those in North Korea. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our nation, for those in authority, and for all in public service, for Joe Biden, our president, and for Muriel Bowser, our mayor. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all those who are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all those who have departed this life in the certain hope of the resurrection, in thanksgiving, let us pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. I now invite your petitions and thanksgivings from home. Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. As Christ our Savior has taught us, we are confident to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please rise with me, and let's say the Nicene Creed, declaring what we believe. Church, what do you believe? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. Greet one another in the peace of Christ. You know, if you're worshiping from home, you're not able to join us here in person, we encourage you to reach out to someone else in the church and share a greeting of peace with them today. And that's a great way to stay connected while some of us are still worshiping from home. On that topic, we do have now two in-person services. One is at 10 a.m. in the morning, and the other is at 5 p.m. in the evening. Those are both here at 501 East Street Southeast, our new church building. The cap of attendance on these has been raised in accordance with the mayor's latest order, which we're very grateful for. But you do still need to register in advance for the service so that we know how many people are coming and that we don't exceed that cap. If you are a family with small children, we ask that you show up maybe 5 or 10 minutes early so you can find a place to sit together while still maintaining some distance from other people here in the church building. I want to share with you some things that are going on in the life of our church aside from Sunday services. This Tuesday, May 11th, our cross-cultural ministry team is hosting the first of two Leave Loud discussions. These are discussions over some interviews with Black Christians who have left mostly white churches or church organizations. And it's an opportunity for us to hear what their experience was like and some of the things that made them feel unwelcome and unaccepted in that context so that we can be learning what it looks like for us to be a place where folks from all different cultures are welcomed in our church. So if that's something that interests you, we encourage you to get involved in that. You can contact Somane Megadi or one of our pastors, or you can contact Stephanie Poe to sign up for that. You do need to sign up in advance. Again, that's Tuesday, May 11th at 8 o'clock. A couple of things happening on May 23rd. It is Pentecost Sunday, and in keeping with church tradition, we like to do baptisms on these big feast days in the church year. And so this Pentecost, we have a couple of baptisms of children that are happening. It's not too late. If you have a child or you yourself have come to faith or have never been baptized, this is an opportunity. You could climb in and get baptized or have your child baptized on Sunday, May 23rd. And you could do that at either of the two services. So if you're interested in that, contact me. My details are on the website, or you can reach out to Somane Megadi as well, and we will walk you through what that would look like. Also, a couple of other things on that same day on Pentecost, there will be a fellowship and farewell barbecue in the lawn, and that's a farewell to me and to my family. And so it's also a farewell to you, an opportunity for us to see some of you perhaps for the last time. And so it's bittersweet. It'll be great to hang out and see so many of you all in one place. But also, we are already feeling sad about saying goodbye to you. So do come if you're able. That'll be 3 o'clock to 5 o'clock out in the churchyard here. Also that day, we have a newcomers gathering at 7 p.m. So if you're new, if you've joined the church recently, maybe you've only worshiped with us online, but you know this is the place for you, or you're wondering if it's the place for you, come along to a newcomers gathering on May 23rd at 7 p.m. That will be after the evening service. It will be here at 501 E Street Southeast. This will be, I believe, the first in-person newcomers gathering that we've had in about 14 months. So do come along to that if you're able. And let us know in advance. We'd love to hear from you. Some other things that happen, we've got res groups are starting back up in earnest in early June. If you'd like more information about that, please contact Solmane, who's putting together these groups. He would love to hear from you if you want to find a group for you, or even if you're interested in hosting or leading a small group, please contact him if you'd like to get involved. Some other things you can see going on in the life of our church, I won't go into all of them now. This is the point in our service, however, when we typically take up an offering, and we do this as an act of worship, where we give back to God from the things that are already His. We're not able to do that clearly in a virtual sense, but we do continue to encourage you to give to God as an act of worship. You can find all the details for how to do so on our website, reschurch.org. And with that, let me ask you to stand once again as we sing together this final hymn. It's been great to worship with you here on Res TV. Hopefully we'll get the chance to see you soon in person. But if in the meantime, do let us know how we can be praying for you or supporting you. And with that, let me send you out with the blessing. All our problems, we send to the cross of Christ. All our difficulties, we send to the cross of Christ. All the devil's works, we send to the cross of Christ. And all of our hopes, we set on the risen Christ. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. And now let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.